News from the Hill. I'm your host, Cassandra Patton. And my topic today is the Endowment Scholarship honoring Dr. and Mrs. Henry Bradford, Jr. My guest today is Dr. Mary Stanley and Dr. Barbara Anthony. Thank you and welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
First of all, tell me a little bit about yourself. Dr. Stanley, we'll start with you.
My name is Mary Bates Stanley. I am an alumna of Alabama A&M. I taught at Alabama A&M for over 30 years. I was in the English department. I majored in English, I think I said that, and after having left Alabama A&M, I worked as Title III director at Drake State Technical College. I'm a mother, a grandmother, here in Huntsville.
Thank you. Dr. Anthony?
I also graduated in the class of 1958. We are golden girls. And we just celebrated a wonderful reunion in May. My teaching experience as an elementary education major began in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. And from there I came to council training and worked for about 7 years. Then I came to A&M. I retired. I spent 8 years with a contractor at NASA Marshall Space Flight Center. I am a widow with two grown children, Jason and Janine. Mm-hmm.
Mary, tell us about the scholarship fund.
Well, I've always admired the Bradfords. They have shown love to everybody that I've ever seen them in contact with. And my daughter got married a couple of years ago. I had several other children who announced their wedding at my farm, and they always were in attendance. And I've always wanted to have other people have the opportunity to work with the Bradfords. So I was delighted when my daughter Karen came back here, joined the church down at Church Street, where Dr. Bradford was a pastor, and had the opportunity to sing under Mrs. Bradford, because I used to talk about her so much. But at any rate, seeing them a number of times on the farm and having this desire to make sure that their legacy would live on, I told someone that I would like to start a scholarship by having a brunch or a dinner or something where people would come and contribute money to this fund.
So who all was on the committee?
I looked for my sheet.
Marjorie Battle, Olivia Brandon, Virginia Caples, Edna Coleman, Leroy Daniels, Sandra Daniels, Eugene Dickerson, Karen Fleming. Her daughter was in absentia, but she kept the computer and the telephone going. You know. She was invaluable because she has done so much toward helping to raise money for the
university.
Mary Hurt, as well as Mary Alice Hurt, Cheryl Johnson, Benita King, Ida Malone, Eloise Nicholson, Nina Phipps, Thornton Stanley, Lady Tucker, Richard Tucker, Ann Warren, Geneva Wright, and Allison Young. Forgot to put her on the program, but she was right there with the food the other day.
Committee.
Awesome. Very good.
Awesome.
The thing that was, I think, so special about the program, number one, WJB was just super. Dr. Stanley gave the occasion, as well as Mr. Vital. Of course, he's our institutional advancement person, and they did a good job of saying, in other words, this is an occasion, but there will be others, and we want your support, and that kind of thing. The Huntsville Spiritual Chorale did a call to prayer, and they did the two numbers. One was a hymn, Come Here, Jesus, If You Please, arranged by Roland Carter, and Every Time I Feel the Spirit by William Dawson. And of course, Mrs. Lady Tucker was our mistress of ceremony, who did a fabulous, fantastic job of keeping everything and going moving, and moving. And Dr. Carl Marbury, who is the seventh president of A&M, provided the invocation. Now, he has a special connection with the Bradfords, and of course, he told us about that prior to his beautiful meditation.
We're going to take a break, and we're going to listen to your occasion, and then we'll come back and talk about.
We have come to recognize the many years that Dr. Henry Bradford Jr. and Mrs. Nell Lane Bradford have demonstrated to us how to love and how to give through their service, commitment, dedication, and above all, obedience to God's command. Little children, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. The Bradfords have shown us that love and giving go hand in hand. They love as God loves. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Today, we celebrate you also, because when the committee came to you individually and collectively and asked you to give, you showed your love both to the Bradfords and to the mission of wanting to make it possible for children yet unborn to come to Alabama A&M and continue in a special legacy of giving and loving. This gathering today is the manifestation of what many of us have wanted to do, to recognize Dr. and Mrs. Bradford for their sacrifices on our behalf as they struggled with our sour notes and flat and wide open tones during choir rehearsal, for enriching our lives through our greater appreciation of the various types of music, for instilling in us great morals and ethical principles, for insisting that we always carry ourselves in a dignified and wholesome manner, and always recognize that God is our maker and sustainer. We thank you, Dr. and Mrs. Bradford, and we want to show that we love you by giving our time and finances to make it possible that other young people will come to Alabama A&M and participate in the spirit of excellence and in the legacy of loving and giving, which you have so richly bequeathed to us. Thank you very much.
Okay, now you guys were talking about your experiences with the Bradfords, singing in the choir. Tell us a little more about that experience.
I said in my tribute to the Bradfords about how we had a sermon each Sunday when we had our worship services where the choir sang. We had Reverend Bradford's sermon each Sunday. Mm-hmm. And during the week at choir rehearsal at 7 o'clock, we often had a sermon from Mrs. Bradford, who told us how to sing and how to do and just some general life kinds mm-hmm. of things also, in addition to the musicianship that she wanted us to exhibit.
Now, Dr. Anthony, I know that you did the tribute, okay? We're gonna listen to that tribute as we take a break, okay?
Oh, okay.
Better is the ending of a thing than the beginning thereof. The time is 2 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon in May of 1955. The scene is the auditorium of Lakeview High School, Guntersville, Alabama. The occasion is a baccalaureate ceremony for the five graduates of the class of 1955. The graduates, students, and community listened attentively to the speaker who explored this text from Ecclesiastes 7:8, and he's surprised that I remember that. The New English Version says, "The end of a matter is better than its beginning." He brought his message clearly, distinctly, and carefully. I was immediately hooked.
I had never heard that kind of sermon. So clear, so understandable, so relevant. I could listen to such a sermon every Sunday. I could go to A&M College. The deal was sealed when he complimented me for accompanying the choir as they sang, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates." The accompanist was ill, and I had to play for them, so he thought I could play. Yes, I was going to go to A&M, especially after he talked to my mom about the possibility of my working and being able to attend A&M. See, Mary, there were no scholarships then, right? I am so thankful for Dr. Bradford and his assistance in this area. For my mom, a widow and a domestic worker, this was the opportunity she had prayed for her only baby. Dr. Bradford was my Sunday school teacher, my chaplain, my music appreciation teacher, and several of my music classes. He was also my private piano teacher. Now, he was busy, and sometimes he didn't make all of my lessons, to my relief, because often I was not really as prepared as I should have been. I also joined the college choir directed by Mrs. Bradford. She was a stern, and somebody stole my word, no nonsense, who was that? Disciplinarian when it came to music and her classes. In addition to Dr. Bradford's sermons on Sunday, we heard many sermons at the 7 o'clock nightly choir practices. You remember that, Michael? To my surprise, one quarter when I went to my private piano lesson, who would walk in as my teacher? None other than Mrs. Bradford. That put a new twist in the time I spent practicing. But I made a hit with her in the Music for Elementary School class. I could play the piano. I exhibited a bit of creativity in presenting my lessons. I could do the folk dances, and I could hold a tune. That was a very, very enjoyable A. Some of my class members were not so fortunate, Geneva, in getting the left hand to cooperate in playing those chords. My heart went out to them as they struggled under her watchful eye. Through the years, my relationship with the Bradfords continued with frequent alumni choir events as well as other musical activities. One event in my life that brought it home to me what a wonderful, compassionate, nurturing couple they are is when I lost my husband just 12 days shy of 35 years of marriage. You would have thought that he was my pastor, but we know that he is a community pastor. They were there. He offered to counsel with me and my children during this time of great grief. They were there 2 years later when my son graduated from high school. Through the years, they always inquire about my children, my family. They willingly offer encouragement and counsel along with spiritually based statements pertinent to whatever the situation is. The promise of prayer for the situation is always a part of the conversation. When it comes time for the alumni choir to prepare for an event, I'm not sure who's happier, us or them. When we get together, we practice, we sing, we reminisce, we hear sermons, and we just love that experience. It takes us back to those days. We are better for our experience with the Bradfords. They brought light into many lives that could have been devastated by the threat of so many of this world's darkness. As James Thurber says, there are two kinds of light, the glow that illuminates and the glare that obscures. They opened our eyes, they illuminated us. Yes, there are glares, there are blinding lights, but from Mrs. Bradford, even a glare, when we hit a wrong note, or not kept our eyes on her as we sang, was quite illuminating. My conversation with the Bradfords on yesterday ended with Dr. Bradford expressing his thanks to God for what we were doing for them. I quickly said, and I hope you understood me, Dr. Bradford, because I kind of got choked up, okay? I said, and we are doing this because we are thankful for what you have done for us. To God be the glory for the things they have done. We thank you, and we thank God. May your legacy live on in us and in the lives of those who will benefit from the scholarships this effort will afford. Amen.
Dr. Anthony, you were talking about these tributes before we went to break.
Right. As I was saying, these people really, and it was really an accident, mm-hmm. represented the gamut of the influence mm-hmm. that the Bradfords had. Dr. Pena, the conductor, Reverend Jonas Rutledge, who has become a minister, and there are several others who have become ministers. And Miss Arthurine Shackelford, although she was not a music major, she was a voice student mm-hmm. who took voice lessons under Mrs. Bradford. She was the soloist in the choir. Beautiful voice. And she told the story of how disciplined that Mrs. Bradford wanted everybody to be and how hard she worked and all of this. And she was saying that once she was taking a nap and she had to go to meet Mrs. Bradford for a class, I believe, and her roommates really woke her up laughing at her because in her sleep she had sat up in the bed and sang this long note and then went back to sleep. It showed the influence of her, Mrs. Bradford, on her really getting her mind on what she mm-hmm. had to do, because she would always tell us, you should be able to sing this song mm-hmm. in your sleep. If I call you at 3 o'clock in the morning, you should be able to sing your part. And that was just how she was uh-huh. with us. And we were obliging. Mm-hmm. We tried to do what she said, and it just gave us an idea
that you could do this. Mm-hmm. You know, you can do this. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Arthurine was very, very good. Mm-hmm. She's an engineer, not a music major, but she related her experience with Mrs. Bradford in mm-hmm. particular as a voice student. Then we had Mr. Anthony Stinson, who is a teacher, a mathematics major mm-hmm. who teaches math in the DeKalb County Schools in Atlanta. He spoke about his experience, and it just so happened a few weeks ago the Bradfords went to a church with their grandson. Didn't know at the time that Anthony Stinson was the guest conductor at that mm-hmm. church, and he said of all the churches in Atlanta, they had to pick the church that he was going. They didn't know that.
Wow.
And he said when the preacher was introducing him as the guest conductor, mm-hmm. because the lady who was the conductor had gone out of town and had asked him to stand in for her, he looked out and saw the Bradfords, and he said wow. he was just amazed. But he remembered the things that he had been uh-huh. taught, you know, keep your cool, mm-hmm. do what you know you can do. And Mrs. Bradford and Dr. Bradford said that the choir did a beautiful job mm-hmm. under him, mm-hmm. even though he was not the regular conductor.
Awesome. Well, we're going to take another break, and we're going to listen to the Bradford's message.
Now, what can I say for a marvelous blessing like this? One of the good songs that I like to beat, the Lord is blessing me right now. Yes, it's just marvelous indeed. You know, some very beautiful words were written by a man whose name was Charles Wesley. He was a brother to John Wesley, who was the founder of the United Methodist Church. And he wrote the words to him which was set to music by Lowell Mason. Lowell Mason was the gentleman who was responsible for starting music education in this country. He started it in the New England states, and it began to catch on, and it spread to other parts of the United States. So this is a sort of correlation here between Lowell Mason and Charles Wesley. If we've done anything, I think that it's been based upon two principal words that I thought about several nights ago. One is a four-letter word, base, B-A-S-E. And the other one is a four-letter word, L-O-V-E. And base, I figure to be legacy. The students who came to us in years gone by came with a legacy. They didn't know it, but the legacy was in the form of an autobiography. What they brought with them, many of them come into college for the first time. We're talking about 30, 40, 50 years ago. And some of them coming to chapel on the first Sunday in university, because we try to do everything in a high-powered way. I don't second guess. I don't second do nothing. It's got to be right. And so some of them had never seen a hymn book. Some of them had never had any experience with holding a printed musical score in their hands. But they brought a bass with them. And the call of God was based upon the text from Charles Wesley's words. A charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save, to fit it for the sky. To serve this present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my powers engage to do my master's will. And that's what we've tried to do since we've been Alabama A&M and all the other places where we were privileged to serve. To build on that legacy, to build on that base, and not only to impart information, but also to engage in transformation. And based upon some of the things that I have heard today, some of you have been unknowingly, knowingly transformed. And we thank God that that transformation took place. But as I think about you, many of you, and pray for you now, I want another transformation to take place. That's going to come when you close your eyes in death on this world, and you'll be transformed into something else. Ah, oh, Lord. I better shut up now, Lord. But the other thing is love. I don't think that anybody can teach effectively in any area of learning, except that there is a love for those whom they serve. I think that's true of professors behind desks. I think that's true of researchers bent over their tables. I think that's true of preachers who stand in pulpits and pastors who serve congregations. That unless you love people and you want them to become in the likeness of Almighty God and to utilize, the base that they have within them, build on the autobiography that they have brought with them to transform them into something better so that they can become and become and become, then you ought not be in the profession, either one of them. That's what's supposed to take place in this world. That's why our Lord was so constantly bothered with Peter. You know Peter the apostle? Doing all kinds of things with his impetuosity and his fast tongue, cutting ears off of people, denying the Lord, not wanting to tell the Lord who he was until he just nailed him to the cross 3 times, and he finally told him who he was. But God, Jesus kept dealing with him and dealing with him and dealing with him, because Jesus could see the potential that was within Peter. And he kept on working with him, and kept on working with him, and kept on working with him until he transformed him. And when he told the Lord who he was, he said, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but the Holy Spirit. Upon this rock, I'll build my church. It wasn't upon Peter. Sometimes we confuse that in some of our theology. But he was building it upon the truth which had been spoken. And so that's what we've tried to do as we've tried to serve. Work with the base and appropriate love. And I hope that you will do the same thing as I'm going to keep on doing until I can't do it anymore. And this lady who's standing beside me, I loves to death. Because you see, I had a base, and she realized that I had a base. I had my own autobiography, but she built on my base, and she transformed me. And that's why I love her. Amen. You want to say something, honey?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right.
But let me say again, I want to thank you for all this money that you have been kind enough to give so freely and all of the levels of your contributing. We thank you very, very much from the bottom of our hearts. Somebody is going to be blessed. Some base is going to be strengthened. And somebody is going to know love. Amen.
Thank you so very much. I'm usually not the talker in the family, as you can well see. I learned a long time ago that I was to allow him to do the talking. I had a statement that I used to say to myself, that marriage is a duet. As one sings, the other one is supposed to applaud. So I have been in the applauding business most of the time, allowing him to do the singing or whatever. But this has just been so refreshing and so wonderful. I sat there and said to myself, I certainly wish Soledad O'Brien could be here to see Black in America as we know it. Because this actually is Black in America. This is what it's all about. And some of the things that we saw were true, yes, but so many of the things that we did not see are also true. And this is an example of it, I think, more than anything else. It has just been wonderful as I look around and see so many of you. I'll start with some of the people that came up and spoke when I saw Dr. Panion, and it does my heart so good to say that, you know, yeah. Because I remember him when he came to A&M and played his trombone and sang in the choir and did all these things, and now I see him with his beautiful family, his children and his wife, and he's doing such wonderful things in the world, and I just rear back and say, I know him. He came to A&M and all of that. And I do the same with all of you. Miss Arthur Reen, who came up and spoke, and she sings, you know, in town often, and I sit in the audience and I applaud and just smile, just, you know, all over myself because I'm so proud of all of them. Michael was singing and Anthony is conducting and all of these things. I tell you, you don't know how I feel when I see all that. And see that these were all students that came to A&M, and we had a chance to work with them and to love them and to nurture them and to spank them when they needed it and to, you know, and to correct them when they, all that. And when I see the Alpha Ensemble sing, you know, I ask them every time when I see them, have you folks practiced before you get up here? You know, and he tells me, said, well, Miss Bradford, we went over in the restroom and warmed up. I said, well, just be sure you do it every time. Don't be getting up singing for people, you know, if you have not rehearsed. You know what I'm saying? Okay. All right. You know, so, and they allow me to do that even at this point, and I appreciate that. And Jonas coming up here, you know, with his family. All of you who have just come from near and far, it just does our hearts so good to see you and to know that you still love us and love A&M, and you want to be a part of all the things that are going on at A&M. If there's anything we can do, you know that we're always available. So you call us day or night, and we will do the best we can. And Mrs. Lady Tucker.
Hello.
And Mr. Tucker. Yes. And Mrs. Hall, all of whom have worked
Mary
with
Curry.
Us in the music department at A&M. We love you, you know that. Have loved you over the years, and we continue to love you wherever we see you. And all of the friends, I hope I'm not leaving out anybody. And my dear little goddaughter, Danielle, playing her violin. You know, I remember the day she was born. And I cried as hard as her mother and daddy did. I'm telling you. Because we were waiting for her when she got here. See, so all of those things just make my heart so, so warm and fuzzy as I feel here. And I'm usually not the talker, I told you. Because I learned 61 years ago that you do better when you let him do the talking. You see, and he allowed me to just step back and, you know, and sometimes he'll ask me, what shall I say? I say, well, darling, you just say whatever you want to, you know. And I will applaud it, whatever it is. So, you know, that's the way it is, okay? So if I have missed anybody, if I have missed calling anyone's name, please forgive me. I'm just so happy to see all of you. I appreciate so much all the things that you have done and our family who's here. Andrea sang last week in Atlanta, and we brought her on back here with us, and she said she would come on, so we're happy, and Hank drove up, and my grandson, you know, who is a part of whom we just have just enjoyed a rearing after these two were grown, then we had another chance to start all over again, and it has just been a pleasure to do that. We're proud of him and our children and all of you who are our children as well. So please know that we are proud of you wherever you are. And if you ever see me in the audience and you're going to sing or speak or do whatever, don't get scared. See, just say that I'm sitting there praying for you. And that's what I'm doing. I'm just pulling for you, even if I don't know you and you are the child of somebody I know. Like Ted Dixie. He gets up to sing. I said, boy, I knew your mama. I don't know you so well, but you sing, boy. You just get on up there and do what you're supposed to do. You know, so it's that feeling that I want to express to you today. And thank you so very much for all of the lovely things that you have said about us. I just hope that we will someday deserve all those things.
Amen.
But it's just been a pleasure for us to do all the things that we try to do, and we'll just keep on doing them. And I thank the Lord every day that he has allowed us to live as long as he has and to be in good health so that we can enjoy these kinds of things, because that would not have had to happen at all. You know that. So we certainly give God the glory for all of these things, and we appreciate you. We are proud of you. We love you, and we want you to continue to love us and to keep on doing what you're doing. These scholarships, you know that makes my heart good, because I can just see those children. And the ones that get the scholarships, all I want to say to them is, how do you get to Carnegie Hall? Practice, practice, practice. That's all. All right. Thank you.
Well, now, I'm going to ask you one thing. Who's the talker?
Ladies, tell me about the musical tributes.
So we had one of the groups was the Alpha Ensemble. Mm-hmm. Everybody in Huntsville is familiar with the Alpha Ensemble. And when we were planning this, somebody said, well, I don't know, but won't you get to them and tell them? Because, you know, they like to do medleys, and they may go too long. But at any rate, everybody always loved for them to go long. And so they did beautiful, they did a beautiful medley for us. And then in the end, they asked the audience to chime in on a very beautiful and appropriate song called If I Can Help Somebody, which was very, very appropriate for the Bradfords. And then their goddaughter, Lady Pollard, did a tribute to them on her violin. It was moving, it was very. Before that though, she spoke about how they had supported her all through college and how they had been real godparents to her. That's just like the Bradfords. Because everybody, that was ringing through everybody's tribute. When I came to Huntsville, not only were they my teachers, mm-hmm. but they were parents, second parents. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. so that was very good. Mm-hmm. But the music from her violin, is just, she played it from her heart for mm-hmm. the years that they have been meant so much to her. And then Doris Hall, who expressed how happy she was because they gave her her job mm-hmm. that she's been in now over 20-some years, mm-hmm. probably. Mm-hmm. Hers was different because she was up in a gazebo away from the crowd.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And she played from up there, higher level than mm-hmm. we were sitting. Mm-hmm. And it seems as if the music really did come from the sky, the trees.
In addition, I say that Mr. Moines did a one-man show mm-hmm. in getting all of the sound systems and the camera mm-hmm. and all. He was running over that place like I don't know what, and he did in the heat, right. He did a fantastic mm-hmm. job. If it wasn't right, I mean, he'd run over there and adjust this mm-hmm. and, you know, make it right. It was. He did a fantastic
mm-hmm.
job.
He did. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, there was another music student mm-hmm. who's also was one of my students. He's Dr. Michael Hambrick, who is a tenor and uh-huh. sang solos in the choir. And he was moved up because the dance theater lost directions or they didn't get to the farm on time. Mm-hmm. So he started the musicals off. Mm-hmm. And I've forgotten what he sang, but I remember it was very, very
My tribute. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. He was accompanied by Cleopha Pair. Mm-hmm. Who had to leave. That's why they moved him up.
Oh, is that it? Okay.
Cleopha had to leave, so they moved him up, but Michael stayed. Mm-hmm. Michael also sings with the alumni choir when we mm-hmm. sing for Founders Day,
okay.
As well as authoring, yes. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. But he did a wonderful job. And then because they moved it up, I had to come after him.
With your voice.
And I was just really moved mm-hmm. because his solo was so mm-hmm. appropriate mm-hmm. and so beautifully done.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that was the brunt of the music, but it made the day.
We forgot to mention that their family was here, the family,
oh, yes. uh-huh.
the daughter, Andrea Bradford, who is a professional mm-hmm. person in music herself, the son, Dr. Henry Lane Bradford from St. Louis, drove down, uh-huh. as well as the grandson.
And might I tell you something, Barbara, about mm-hmm. that? Because Hank, I don't know what instrument, I know he was in the band at Lee, uh-huh. but upon riding back to St. Louis with him, Martha mentioned to me that he says he's
Martha
taking
Christmas.
Martha Christmas, mm-hmm. who came from St. Louis, that he said he's taking music lessons now.
Oh.
That his mom had tried to get him to do that, mm-hmm. and he didn't. And he said he wished he had listened to her.
Okay.
So he's now taking some, I don't know whether piano or what.
Oh, wonderful.
But he does play his drums too,
right.
at a church in St. Louis.
Oh, good, good. Uh-huh.
Thank you for watching. This is the Telecommunications and Distance Learning Center here at Alabama A&M University. We're going to leave you with sights of the Bradford Scholarship Fund.
Wonderful morning. What better words to describe this day as we find ourselves in a unique setting with a lofty goal, honoring two citizens of Huntsville who are icons to us and many across this country.
If I can help somebody
as they have us.
As I can.
In life, our acknowledgments, the acknowledgments others have, how they've impacted our lives are usually done at memorial ceremonies, but I'm certainly honored that the Bradfords are being honored here today. It's obvious to me that their peers, former students, colleagues, family and friends will be the legacy that they leave here behind to us. And now that you all have created an endowment in perpetuity, others will experience their legacy.
For the things he has done, just let me leave my life. Let it be pleasing, oh Lord, to thee.
My father, who took me to the bus station when I was coming to A&M in 1953, believe it or not, carried me from my home over to Leeds in an old wagon about a mile away. And he didn't say very much, but one of the things he said that stayed with me, he said, "Now we have tried, your mother and I have tried to be good parents and to take good care of you, and we think you're all set. But when you get up to this place at A&M, I believe there are some people that you're going to get automatically attached to because they remind you of your mother and I." And that's all he said. And sure enough, when I got to A&M, there were the Bradfords. And they have been my adopted parents ever since. I went off to Oberlin College because of them. That's our connection.
Lifetimes, we probably can count on one hand the number of people that we'll come in contact with that really will have a lasting impact on us. You know, those life-changing people that you come in contact with. Dr. and Mrs. Bradford really were that and are that to this day for me. Just the way they care of themselves, more than just music. I came to A&M and, you know, just wanted to be a musician, but when I graduated from A&M, the things that I had learned about life, learned about carrying myself as a gentleman, or even learning from Mrs. Bradford how to treat women. I mean, that may seem like a small thing to you, but it's a really, really important thing. And just all the things that are that have made me, I believe, who I've become. Their legacy is just long-lasting and deep in my life.
You've done so much for me. Back in 1963, a little boy from Montevallo, Alabama, from the cotton fields of Montevallo, Alabama, came to Alabama A&M University on faith, and it was on faith. My mom and dad had to borrow the money to get me started at A&M, not knowing how they were going to get the money to keep me in school. Sure enough, after the first semester, I got this call from home saying, "Son, you're going to have to come home because we don't have the money for your second semester tuition, so you're going to have to drop out and come home." So my mother decided she would make up a speech as to why I had to come home. But Dr. Bradford had given me a little job, and I was working for him, and I called Dr. Bradford and told him I had to drop out of school, and I didn't even have my fare home. And I asked him, I said, "Do you have something around your house that I can do to get my bus fare home? Dr. Bradford said, yes, we all have always have something to do around the house, but meet me in my study. So I met Dr. Bradford in his study. I don't have 3 minutes. I met Dr. Bradford in his study. He called my mother and said, Mrs. Rutledge, do you mind me letting Jonas have the money for his tuition? I don't care how he's going to pay me back. Can I let him have it? She said, oh, this is the Lord on the phone. This is the Lord on the phone. So sure enough, Dr. Bradford let me have the money for my tuition, not knowing how I was going to repay it. I said, Dr. Bradford, I don't know how I'm going to repay it. He said, don't worry about it.
Oh, I want to see him look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice.
I have to say, I was very honored to be asked by Dr. Anthony to give a tribute to Mrs. Bradford as one of her former voice students. Many years ago, I arrived at Alabama A&M University filled with nervous anticipation. Little did I know what lay in store for me. My high school instructors in choral music and band had prepared me well for the strict rehearsal schedules and discipline required for the Alabama A&M University choir. But prior to studying voice with Mrs. Bradford, my experience as a soloist was primarily in gospel music. I had no idea what Mrs. Bradford had planned for me as one of her voice students, for she is the one who introduced me to operatic singing. There were times she would present vocal techniques to me that I found to be a bit challenging. For example, one afternoon, I decided to take a nap in my dorm room while my roommate and another friend were present. You see, they were also taking voice with Mrs. Bradford. Now, I must add a seemingly unrelated point. My sister, roommate, and close dorm mates all knew that I talked in my sleep. Now, back to my anecdote. Eventually, I awakened to the laughter of my friends. They said that while I was sleeping, I sat up in my bed, sang a note, properly crescendoed, laid back down, and kept right on sleeping. Now that's what I call impacting a student.
And reflecting on good parenting leads to my second P word. When I think of Dr. and Mrs. Bradford, and that word is pride. Dr. and Mrs. Bradford taught me about taking pride in all that I do. For example, there were times during our analysis and counterpoint classes, Father Bradford put the textbook aside and talked to us about taking pride in being intelligent African Americans in a world where good was not good enough. Mother Bradford told us, when you stand to sing, you must have the look which says, I am here to sing, I know how to sing, I know what to sing, and I'm going to sing it for you. Thank you for instilling pride in me.